I want to focus today on the economy. My worry is that whatever be the intentions of the government, and let me assume that the intentions are good, I do not see an overarching vision of how the economy will go forward. And I don't see how that vision is being translated into specific policies. And I don't see how those policies are being broken down into specific programs and being implemented. In fact, at the end of my column, which is where I wish to start today, I have listed issues which are worrying issues. My concern is the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister and the government are not reading the tea leaves correctly. There are worrying signs. I've listed five, but I can add more to that. Credit growth is sluggish, in fact, the lowest in many years. Aggregate demand is low. The core sector is performing very poorly. A large number of projects, according to Dr. Rangarajan this morning, 161 in the public sector and 585 in the private sector are stalled. FSLRC recommendations are not being implemented. The direct access code has been dumped. And a number of other things which could have been done with 282 in the Lok Sabha have been put on the back burner. Now add to this some other issues that have been highlighted by other eminent writers and columnists. It's been pointed out that oil prices are rising again. Gold imports have surged. That will impact the current account deficit. India will remain a net importer of coal, despite your boast that the coal auctions were a great success. Exports, after many, many years, have shown negative growth in 2014-15 and a number of other issues. So I think it's time for the opposition to ask, for the media to ask, and it's the obligation of government to answer how they read these worrying signals and what is the way forward. I think I'll stop here and we'll take questions. And if necessary, I'll make a statement at the end.
Mr. Arun Jaitley, he has accused your party of positioning itself against development and growth, which he said might derail the double-digit growth objective.
Well, I don't agree. In fact, it was Mr. Arun Jaitley who, in a speech in London and repeated on another occasion, said, obstructionism is a legitimate parliamentary tactic. But we are not obstructing. Did we obstruct the insurance bill? They obstructed the insurance bill for five successive sessions. I was virtually imploring them to pass the insurance bill. They obstructed it for five sessions. We passed it after 3 months. Did we obstruct the black money bill? We had reservations of the black money bill, but we allowed it to be passed. What are we obstructing? We have asked that the GST be referred to a standing committee and to be reported back in 2 months. They have made 8 amendments to the bill that was introduced by our government. What is wrong in a standing committee taking a look at those 8 amendments and taking 2 months? Is 2 months obstructionism? I reject the argument that we are obstructing. I wish him well in his aspiration to have double-digit growth. But he won't have double-digit growth by simply accusing the opposition.
Mr. Chidambaram, I have a question. Arun Jaitley has said that Congress suffers from legislative literacy. Now the last 1 year of good governance and dictatorial, has it made you any wiser?
I don't understand. What has illiteracy got to do with wisdom? A lot of people who are not literate are also wise. a lot of people who are very literate are unwise. What has that got to do with each other?
Do you accept that you suffer from legislative illiteracy?
I don't know what that means. We are not drafting legislation. Those who draft legislation must be literate. We are not drafting legislation now. I don't know what that means.
So coming back to GST, you saw those 8 amendments. Does it change because these are part of, you know, the standing committee recommendations that have come? These have been discussed, delivered, and so really it was more politics postponing it than anything else. So do you have any fundamental differences with those 8 amendments?
That is
or you would just want to leave it to a standing committee and delay it?
That is a question that should be put to the elected members of parliament. The members of parliament felt that this is an important constitutional amendment. It deserves to go to a standing committee. All bills must go to a standing committee. In fact, it is this government which is bypassing the standing committee. I believe some 45, 50 bills have been passed bypassing the standing committee. But if parliament, elected members of parliament, believe that a constitution amendment bill that will fundamentally change the taxation structure of this country should go to a standing committee and we should take 2 months for that, I think it's a perfectly legitimate request.
But do you have any fundamental differences with that?
That you must ask the standing committee. I am not a member of the standing committee.
As
a party, yes, our members in the standing committee will articulate the party's position. They will hear other party members. They may modify their position. But after give and take in the standing committee, it is the standing committee which has to come up with a recommendation.
He's saying that there is no price hike.
That's not correct.
Other than pulses.
Urad, moong, and one more dal, arhar, all three dals, there is a price rise. There's a price rise in 3 or 4 key vegetables. All that has been documented. These numbers have been published. There's a price rise in milk. Now, it's not correct to say that there's no price rise. While retail inflation has indeed come down, there are at least 3 dals and 4 or 5 vegetables and milk where there is a considerable price rise hurting the average family. Well,
except some seasonal, he admitted that some seasonal.
Okay, I'm glad he admitted that. Now, inflation began to decline in November 2013. I want you to note these dates because sometimes I find that the media simply has no memory. November 2013, inflation began to decline. And see the graph of both WPI and CPI, secular decline from November 2013 downward. In November 2014, that is within 6 months of the old government going out of office and the new government coming, WPI touched zero. Are you seriously suggesting, is Mr. Jaitley seriously suggesting that WPI became zero only during those 6 months and nothing that happened before has an impact? November 2014, WPI became zero. And since then, it has become negative. Therefore, the decline in prices is attributable to measures taken by the UPA government as well as the measures taken by the NDA government. But the biggest contributor has neither been the UPA nor the NDA. The biggest contributor to the decline is our friends who produce oil. Oil prices have halved. I wish that during the 10 years of our government, oil prices had been at $40 a barrel.
Sir,
just a moment, you decide who will ask.
Sir,
I'll come back. I'll come.
क्या सुप्रीम कोर्ट जाना चाहेगी कांग्रेस या सपोर्ट करेगी सुप्रीम कोर्ट में अपील करने के लिए?
For what?
क्या रहता कि?
I don't know. That is a subject which is entirely within the domain of the Karnataka government. I believe the Karnataka cabinet is meeting today or tomorrow to take a decision. I have nothing further to say, and I would request that this press conference be kindly confined, at least the first part of it, to questions on the economy.
Sir, Rahul Gandhi
has given the government zero out of ten. What is your rating for the Prime Minister as well as the Prime Minister?
I don't believe in rating anyone. It's the people who must rate. Each one sees from his point of view. If you ask the farmer today, the average farmer, I come from a largely rural constituency. I was there for the last couple of days. I visited twice a month. The average farmer today, as well as Dr. Ashok Gulati, one of the foremost agricultural experts in this country, will give it 0 out of 10. But if we ask a big industrialist who was promised 5,000 crore by the State Bank of India, he will of course give it 10 out of 10. So it depends on who is answering the question, from what point of view you're answering the question.
Sir, it's being said after that the claim by BJP that last 1 year saw no scams, no scandals in the good role. Do you buy this?
There was no scandal, no scam in the UPA's 2004-2005, 2005-2006, 2006-2007. So what kind of a comparison is this? I'm happy that there is no scam, as if I wish a scam. We don't wish a scam. I'm happy that there is no scam. But only time will tell whether right decisions are being taken or wrong decisions are being taken. I do not wish them to take wrong decisions. If they take right decisions, we are very happy.
Aditi.
Fiki said the same thing to us when we came to office in 2004. Fiki said the same thing to Mr. Vajpayee when he came to office in 1999. And I remember Fiki said the same thing to me when I first came to office in 1996. No, industry has credibility. Its credibility believes, the foundation for its credibility is its so-called political neutrality. It will say the same thing. That's not the point. Your question is a very serious question. Let me answer that. National Skill Development Mission under Mr. Ramadure continues, named today Skill India. Nirmal Bharat Abhiyan, renamed as Swachh Bharat. Aam Aadmi Bima Yojana, Rashtriya Swasth Bima Yojana, renamed as Pradhan Mantri -- Yojana. Financial inclusion, of which Dr. Rangarajan was a passionate advocate, zero balance account, no frills account, renamed as Jan Dhan. In fact, the best praise is, the best flattery is imitation. I'm very happy that the NDA government is imitating or following our policies and continuing with that. Why should I not be happy? I'm very happy with that. That's not correct. Take the financial inclusion. Until 31st March 2014, we had added 24 crore accounts. Please send a letter to the RBI, they will confirm the number. Send an RTI to the RBI, 24 crore accounts. Since then, until last month, they said they had added 12.36 crore accounts. Now they're saying they've added 14 crore accounts. So the 14 crore accounts stands on the shoulder of the 24 crore accounts. The total number of accounts are not 14 crore. The total number of accounts are 38 crore. So why do you say we have not implemented it? Take Swachh Bharat, individual toilets. Go to the Planning Commission records, go to the Annual Economic Survey. Every year they put out the number of individual toilets that have been constructed. This government is doing the same thing. They want to build individual toilets. I think their target is 1.2 crore this year. That's good. We also built individual toilets. They're also building individual toilets. It's a perfectly right thing to do. So why do you say, all that I can say is, in hindsight, we have not trumpeted our accomplishments as well and as cleverly as this government. Very well, don't go all over the world. I don't think all over the world, Jandan and Swachh Bharat have resonance. Let's talk about India now. I think we have to acknowledge that they have advertised their work better.
Aditya.
You see, it's all very easy to say you're a crony capitalist and I'm pro-development. Let's take the two examples that you gave. I'm not for a moment holding a brief for any irregularity or illegality that may have been committed. We are talking about policy. The spectrum allocation policy on a first-come, first-served basis was started in 1993, and the first 20-year licenses expired or will expire in December 2014. Since 1993, how many governments have been there in this country? Since 1993, we've had successive governments, including a BJP government, which followed the same spectrum allocation policy. Take, for example, coal allocation. The Act is a 1954 Act. I wish some of you look at Section 5 and Section 11 of the Act that allows for an application, allows for a first-come, first-served, allows for the central government to make an allocation of a coal mine. That policy has been followed by successive governments since the Act was made. Therefore, all governments which follow the policy are crony capitalists. Is that the conclusion? No. If there has been an irregularity and illegality favoring someone, that is a matter of concern and therefore accusation. But simply following a policy is not crony capitalism. Please remember, it is our government which recorded 8.5% average growth in the period of 10 years. The highest growth ever recorded in any 10-year period in the history of India. You cannot record 8.5% growth by being a crony capitalist government. You can be a government of development, pro-growth, and then show 8.5% growth. I wish the present government exceeds our growth rate. When they do that, I will compliment them. But don't point fingers when our record shows that the growth during our period was 8.5%. And by the way, what do you say of an incident where the Prime Minister, in the presence of a senior banker and a senior industrialist, makes a statement, yes, Bank A will give industrialist B 5,000 crore. What do you call that?
Was that said publicly?
Of course it was said publicly. You reported it.
One second.
No, no, we are not answering questions from the party.
After you.
But I decline to answer. But I decline to answer the question.
Please, please ask.
I decline. This press conference is about the economy of India. I decline to answer that question. I'm sorry.
They were ashamed of being Indian, would you say?
Were you ashamed? I was not ashamed. I was born many, many years ago. I was not ashamed to be born in India. I ask every one of you, was anyone here ashamed before 26th May 2014 that he was born in India. If any one of you is ashamed, please ask the question and I'll answer the question.
Sir, coming back to the point.
Can we, one question. Let that be the last, ma'am, then we'll go back.
You have to speak a little louder. Tax terrorism was a phrase coined by Mr. Jaitley when he was in the opposition. It's come to haunt him now. All that he's doing is being accused as tax terrorism. All that his ministry is doing is being accused as tax terrorism. So I think one should be careful before one coins slogans and words. The only case on which I had then and I have now serious reservations is the Vodafone taxation case. But we have publicly said that we have to find a solution to that problem. I tried to find one. Vodafone tried to meet me halfway, but finally they backed off. We could not find one. I asked the question, why does the present government, with 282 members in the Lok Sabha and no baggage of the earlier amendment bill, with no baggage at all, why are they not resolving the Vodafone problem? It can be done by simply adding one clause to the finance bill, which is the money bill. It does not require the support of the Rajya Sabha. Why have they not solved that problem? And what is their answer to all the charges of tax terrorism that is being leveled against them? You are taxing FIIs, you are taxing FPIs, you are imposing MAT. So I think one must be very careful when one coins attractive slogans. No, I think Vodafone is a one-off case. Vodafone is a one-off case. It should have been handled differently. I tried my best to resolve the problem in the months that I had towards the end of the UPA government. I tried very hard, but I could not succeed. The next government should have followed it up and cleaned up that problem.
Vigilance.
I told you, I'm not in the business of marking. That's your business.
But still,
Sunil.
I'm not in the business of marking. If you ask me specific issues, I will answer. Jobs. Let's take jobs.
Yeah.
I don't see any creation of jobs. In fact, the last numbers that have come is, for the last quarter, October, November, December 2014, some 1 lakh jobs were created. And I saw some statistic yesterday on the employment exchanges of Tamil Nadu, there are 85 lakh people registered. 85 lakh in a state where the population is about 7.5 crore. That's roughly about 1/9 or 1/10. Now, if 10% of your workforce